Hello, my name's James Vasey and I'm the Associate Assistant Head Teacher here at Bingley Grammar School. This video is going to take you through completing the data collection booklet ready for your child to start in September 2021. So our to-do list. We need to complete and return the data booklet back to school as soon as possible. We need you to email in a photograph of your child with their name and date of birth. Email any questions you might have to transition@bingleygrammar.org. So in the photograph that we need you to send in, so it's just a standard head and shoulders photograph, put your child, stand them against a wall, take a photograph of them and email that in with their name and date of birth, transition@bingleygrammar.org. It's as simple as that. We don't need a passport photo booth photographs, that's unnecessary, just with a normal smartphone. They can be dressed normally. They don't need to be in their new school uniform. Please send that in to us, again, as soon as possible. So hopefully, if you're doing this at the same time as completing the data collection booklet, we might get the photograph back before the booklet is posted in to us. If you are appealing for a place at another school, you must still continue your application with us until we have received, until we both receive confirmation of your alternative school place. Okay, you'll have received two booklets from us. This first booklet is the New Starter Summary Policy Pack. That tells you important information like term dates, uniform information, equipment you will require, including calculators. It also tells you how to apply for a school bus pass from Metro, and those basic kinds of information we need to get you started with in September. So please read that. I know it's a bit of light reading, but we do need to go through it. Okay, so this is the student pupil data collection booklet. On page one, we ask you for your child's name and tutor group. At the moment in time, you won't know your child's tutor group, so just write on your child's name. And we'll start going through this booklet. Very important, and it's in red, you must complete and return this booklet. Your child cannot start at Bingley Grammar until we have received this booklet. We do emphasise and enforce this. On the inside cover is a new starter checklist. Please work through it as you go through the booklet to make sure you've completed all the information that we do need. Right at the top, we ask for a copy of your child's birth certificate and or passport or certificate of deed poll if appropriate. Ideally, a copy of your child's birth certificate. If we can't do that, a passport. If you can do both, that's fantastic and we'll take that. If there's been a certificate of deed poll to change a child's name, please include that as well. If there is a court order relating to the child or the family circumstances, please could you include that for our child protection procedure so that we can ensure that your child is safe and that the school is following any of the requirements of the court order as well. Sometimes there are requirements on the school to complete as part of that court order. And as you work through this booklet, please just tick and complete as complete each section. So this section is the beginning. We need to know about the child. We need to know their legal forename, their legal middle name, and their legal surname. That's exactly as it appears on their birth certificate, so that their birth certificate matches their school record, and therefore, when they leave school, their exam certificates match our record and match their birth certificate and match their passport. That's really important for students when they leave, but it's also really important that we have accurate information for us as we have to provide this information to government. Sometimes, however, a child will want to be known by a different name. That's fine, but that will always be a parent's request. So a child cannot change their name. If a parent wants their child to be known as Charlotte and insists that that child is called Charlotte, our teachers will call that child Charlotte. If, however, you, in agreement with your child, want them to be known by a different name, Lottie, for example, in preferred forename, write that in there, and all your teachers will refer to that child by that preferred name. Similarly, if Jonathan and John, or for some children who have Muhammad as their first name and a middle name, if you want, please use that preferred forename box and we will refer to your child by that preferred forename. The preferred surname section, we have a number of parents who have want their child to have a different surname to the one that matches their birth certificate, and that is okay. In the absence of a deed poll, it is a preferred surname. For example, if a child uses their mother's maiden name, that's perfectly okay, but it is a preferred surname. That's the surname we will use in school and all the teachers will refer to your child by. Only on your examination certificates will the legal surname and the legal forename be used. At this moment in time, you won't know their tutor group, so we can move that section on. So we need to know about their gender, date of birth, and their child's current Year 6 primary school. We then need to know their home address and postcode, and the child's own mobile number and own email address, if they have one. We also need to know about any siblings they currently have in school or have had in the last 8 years. The reason why is just to reduce duplication of records, so that there is only one mum, one dad, rather than having lots of records for mum and dad and ending up with mobile phone numbers and email addresses being out of sync. So if you let us know about any siblings, we can match all those records up. The next section is the brief medical information section. There's two medical sections in this booklet. Firstly, the child's NHS number. If you know it, it will be on any prescription, any hospital letter, or in the child's red book, the personal health record book that you'll have, that your child will have got when they were born. We also need to know the child's medical practice, for example, Bingley Medical Practice. We don't need to know it's Dr. Smith, we just need to know the name of the practice and the address and telephone number. We ask for the address and telephone number because a lot of GP practices have two sites, and we need to know which one your child is registered at. Whether your child has any major medical conditions we need to be aware of, so for example, whether it's asthma, whether it's eczema or similar conditions, anything that we need to be aware of, even minor things if possible, please, just so that we've got an accurate record. If your child has an EpiPen, diabetes, epilepsy, or any action plan, or any other kind of health plan that we might need to be aware of, please make a copy of it and send that in to us. If you want to send paper copies, send it in with the data booklet, or if you've got electronic copies, you can email that in to transition@bingleygrammar.org. First big red box question, stop. In an emergency, can we provide or arrange for emergency treatment for your child? Sign yes or no. That allows us to provide first aid treatment on site, but it also allows us to, whilst also getting contact with you, also to contact 999 and make arrangements for ambulances, so that we can take the child or get the child on their way to hospital in the event of a serious illness or serious emergency, rather than having to get in contact with you first and getting your permission. If we've got that permission up front, we're keeping your child safer earlier. Travel and dietary requirements is the next section. How is your child coming to school? By car, by bus, by train? Your child can apply to cycle into school. And if you want to do that, please put that in and we will make sure the forms are sent out to you if they want to come to school on their bicycle. If your child has any dietary needs, halal or kosher, or any special or gluten, things like that, please let us know in that dietary needs section. If they are vegetarian, again, put that in. Our school catering system will warn the catering staff if a child tries to purchase something that is outside of their dietary requirements, and the member of staff will alert and warn that child. If you combine options, for example, in some cases we've had in the past where a parent has written that a child is eats only halal food and has also written vegetarian because they've just copied it across, we will stop them from purchasing meat. And in some cases, that wasn't the intention. So please make sure that when you're putting those dietary requirements in, that it's very clear to us what you what outcome you want. Because if you write halal and vegetarian in the box, we will stop them from eating, purchasing any meat product at from the canteen. Daily meals, will they be bringing a school, eating a school lunch, or will they be purchasing a packed lunch? Next couple of questions are to do with language, country of birth, nationality, ethnicity and religion. The first two questions are compulsory. So, the child's first language that they learnt, that is when they were a toddler and they were learning from mum or from dad, their language acquisition, what was that language? Again, for most children, that will be English. The language now spoken at home, again, for most children, that will be English. But if it's not, please tell us what it is. The next couple of questions are optional, and if you do not want to answer those questions, either leave it blank or mark it as refused to answer. So we'd like to know your country of birth and your nationality. A number of mistakes that are made in this section each year are where people write their nationality and their ethnicity together. So, example, we get a lot of children each year who write that they are British Pakistani. What the question here is as to whether or not you have or are eligible for a passport of a country, in which case nearly all those children were British but had a Pakistani ethnicity, which is the box below. And it's really important to try separate those two things out. If the child is a dual national, please write the nationality, the second nationality in that record. The reason why we collect this information is we collect it for students eventually when they go into sixth form, as it is compulsory information that we need to evidence their eligibility for sixth form education. Ethnicity is an optional question, which you can we would like you to answer, but you can refuse to answer. And the same with religion. If your child does not have a religion, instead of marking it as refused to answer, you can also write no religion. No, we regard no religion and refuse to answer as separate categories. The school receives additional funding for children whose parents have served in the armed forces at any point, at, either currently or up to or from September 2016. If your child, if a parent served in the armed forces from September 2016 or currently serves, or your child is in receipt of a war pension, please tick yes there. If your child has ever been in care for one day or more, was your child adopted from care or under a special guardianship order or residence order? A residence order is not a residency order. So where parents separate and the court gets involved, that's a residency order. That's not the same thing in this circumstance. So a residence order is a court saying that is where a child has come out of local authority care. So residence order and residency, two separate things. Has your child ever received free school meals at any point in the last 6 years? That is also known as the pupil premium. Any child that's coming from year six who is currently in receipt of free school meals will continue to be in receipt of free school meals in year seven. That process is automatic. However, children who are currently in receipt of free school meals in year six may receive a letter from Bradford asking them to confirm which secondary school their child is going to. And that's to ensure that the money is allocated to the correct school. But don't worry, you do not need to reapply if your child is currently in year six, receiving free school meals, or at the moment when this video is recorded, receiving vouchers. Your child will continue to receive that in year seven. You do not need to reapply. So this section now is about emergency contact information and parental responsibility. We request that you provide three emergency contacts. You can provide more if you wish. At least one of those contacts must have legal parental responsibility. In most usual circumstances, that's either the mother or the father of the child. Some families are no longer in contact with either the mother or the father of the child. The school is required to know the name and contact details of all parents. This is to comply with our child protection procedures and the law. You can supply these details on additional paper, even if you only know the most basic details about their name or whereabouts. And if a court order exists stating where a child must live, or that a parent must or must not come into contact with a child, please provide that information as well. This is to help keep your child safe. I must reiterate that an absent parent is still legally a parent, and we need to know about them. So who has parental responsibility? Unless revoked by a court order or adoption, by law, only the following people have legal parental responsibility. All birth mothers. Fathers who were married to the mother at the time the child was born. Fathers who were not married to the mother, but are either registered or re-registered on the child's birth certificate. Civil partners and partners of mothers registered or re-registered as the child's legal parent on the birth certificate. Fathers who have a court-witnessed parental responsibility agreement or a court-issued parental responsibility order. A special guardian appointed by the court or a person with a court order for interim care, emergency protection or residence. Usually that would be a social worker or foster parent. Or an adoptive parent. Therefore, a step parent and other family members such as grandparents or aunts or uncles do not have parental responsibility except where that is provided by court order or adoption. Therefore, for step parents, we will accept a parental responsibility agreement with the birth mother and birth father and the step parent together as a grounds for parental responsibility. But we will require a copy of that agreement for our records before we update and add a parental responsibility to a step parent. If there is any adult over the age of 18 living in the same house as your child who we do not have as an emergency contact, please could you write then a note of their name and relationship to you and the child. This is to comply with our child protection procedures, just so that we know who the adults are that are in that child's life. Obviously, in some cases, the mother or the father of the child will be deceased. If that is the case, please could you write a note so that we are aware of that and we will not contact you regarding that. If we believe that there may be a parent, we will contact you over the summer just to ask some questions, just to make sure that our records are up to date. As children move into secondary school, it is more common for parents, for absent parents and parents not involved in their child, suddenly in year seven to take a sudden interest in their child. The more we know, the more we can keep your child safe in school. So in this section, we're requesting at least three contacts. If you could please provide the details that we've requested. So the relationship to the child. So that's mum, dad, aunt, uncle, grandparent. Again, the first contact should ideally be somebody with parental responsibility. So title, forename, you can put your middle name in there as well, and surname. Date of birth, if known, that helps reduce the number of duplicates we would have on our records, but also it helps for our child protection procedures as it makes it easier if we have to make any referrals to make sure that we're accurately talking about the correct person. Home address, home telephone number, your own mobile and your own email address, please. The bulk of our communication with parents is via email. If you could possibly provide an email address for each parent, that would be fantastic. The next section is your job title, work address, work telephone number and work email address. I've been asked before about this. Why do we collect this information? Well, firstly, we don't mind where you work. We're not interested. Our interest is that in an emergency, we can contact you. We have a number of parents who work in workplaces where they cannot have their mobile phone with them. Therefore, in an emergency, we would need to contact that workplace in order to try and get in contact with a parent. That's the only reason why we ask this information. We ask for your work email address in case you use that to contact the school regarding your child, because we want to make sure that anybody communicating with the school about your child has authorisation to do that, and obviously we want to make sure that anybody emailing in using any email address is the parent. So if you tell us in advance which email address is like your work email address you're going to use, then we can make sure that all the information we receive is legitimate. Ideally, if you could include your national insurance number, that will help match up any records for eligibility for free school meals, and also our child protection procedures, so we can ensure that information is only shared in an emergency. It is not used for any purpose in school. If you are a former student, please could you tick that box just to confirm you are a former student. If there was a maiden name, please use that as well. That's just to ensure that our record system matches up, because we do maintain historical records of your name, date of birth and address and your examination results, just so that if you ever come back for a reference, or that we can make sure that you we just only have one record for one person and we're not creating lots of duplicates there. So we want four contacts, please. Three is a minimum. Four would be ideal. Again, though, if there's anybody else in the household, as I talked about earlier, that you need to make us aware of, you can include that on a separate piece of paper. And then we sign to say that information that you provided is accurate. So we need your consent to use images of children in on the walls, in the school prospectus, and in printed publications such as our website, and we need consent for those images, and that section explains how we would use that information. If you're happy for us to take a photograph of your child for that purpose, please tick yes. If not, please tick no. We are allowed to use, and we have a legal right to use, a photograph for our own internal purposes, which is why we ask for that original photograph. And we'll use that for internal teaching purposes and for pupil well-being. But we would not obviously publish those photographs without your consent. So this section of the booklet is the medicine information. This will be kept separate from the main data booklet, which is why we ask for your child's name on the front, because we'll be pulling that out and keeping that separate. Again, you don't know your child's tutor group at the moment. If your child has any medicine that they need to bring into school, please complete this section here. And in most cases, the child will self-administer their medication, but it will be kept in the first aid office, and Mrs. Parker will keep that information secure, and the medicine secure as well. There is a consent request that a child either self-carries or self-administers their medication. In some cases, it doesn't, as it doesn't need to be stored as securely. So please complete that section as well. And finally, medication at home. If your child receives any medication in the morning or an evening that we might need to inform the ambulance service about, please make a note of it there as well. So even if they're not bringing it into school, if it's a medication that's being prescribed to them, the ambulance service may not know what that medication is or what the condition is for that child. So if you could let us know, please, on there, just so that in an emergency, we can provide that information to the ambulance service, as that obviously might affect the treatment that your child receives for any particular condition. So this is the homeschool agreement. Put the child's name at the top, please. Don't worry about the tutor group, as you don't know it. The parent's going to sign this top section. The pupil will agreeing to that, will sign the middle section. And then I will sign this bottom section upon the you returning this booklet back to school. Permission for trips and visits. Any trip that doesn't involve a cost or can be completed on a one-off permission form, which is this form here, or any school fixture. That way we don't have to write to you every time your child who's in the football team goes and plays a football match. As long as you know, as long we will inform you when those matches are, and your child can use this one consent throughout school to go on those trips and visits. If there is any trip and visit that involves outside of school hours, or other than a PE trip, or any trip that involves a cost, we will write to you separately and ask for your consent for those. These two pages here are about emergency medication. The Department for Education allows us to have emergency medication. It allows us to have emergency salbutamol inhalers, and it allows us to have emergency EpiPens. If your child does suffer from asthma, please complete the section at the top. If they have an asthma care plan, please ensure the copy of that care plan is also returned with a data collection booklet. The bottom section is really important. That's why I've put it in red. If your child does not currently suffer from asthma, we do have emergency asthma inhalers, the salbutamol inhalers, in school. Your child may be fine. However, in an emergency, your child might not be fine. Your child may be struggling to breathe. Your child may have developed asthma. If they need an emergency inhaler, we have them available. But because it is a medicine, we must have parental consent before using it. So if your child does not suffer from asthma, please complete this section. We're not going to give them an inhaler for any particular reason, but in an emergency, we do have them available. And therefore, we would like your consent now to be able to use that in an appropriate emergency. Again, please sign to consent that. If you put no, and there is a medical reason for putting no, please could you let us know so that we can ensure that the ambulance service is also aware of the reason why we're not giving that, because obviously that will affect that may affect the medical treatment they're provided. The same here with the use of an EpiPen or epiphedrine. If your child does suffer from anaphylaxis, from nut allergies and things like that, please complete the section at the top. If your child does not suffer from anaphylaxis, from particular allergies, please be aware of this section. Your child may never have had an allergic reaction to some food. It does not mean that they will not suffer an allergic reaction tomorrow. All our staff have undergone training in the use of EpiPen, every single member of staff. However, our first aid staff have undergone further training. In the event that your child is having a serious, life-threatening allergic reaction, the school has a supply of single-use EpiPens. We would like your permission now to be able to use that where our qualified first aider, in their professional judgment, and on the phone to 999 ambulance service, can provide an EpiPen to your child in an emergency. If you've consent to that, please put yes. If not, press no. Write no. If there is a medical reason why we should not give epiphrine or give them an EpiPen, and it's a medical reason, please can you tell us why? So again, so we can ensure that the ambulance service is aware of the reason why. Again, just so that will affect the treatment that they can provide. And again, please sign that either way. Parents need to sign for their child's acceptable use of the ICT equipment in school, and you can read through that at your leisure as to what your child will and will not do. The school provides financial support for school uniform, which is, I think this year it's £26, as a voucher that can be redeemed at Henry Smith's Andrew Firth, Natasha Schoolware, and at Rawcliffe's. The eligibility for that is that your child is eligible and registered for free school meals, that your child has been registered for free school meals at any point in the last 6 years, any child who has been looked after at any point for one day or more, so that's been in care, any child who has been adopted from care after 2005, or has left care under a special guardianship order or residence order, or any child or any pupil who is a child of UK Armed Forces personnel. These vouchers will be issued in August, but the sooner you can get this form back to us, the sooner we can start to process these claims, as they are, as we do need to get these vouchers ordered. So the sooner we get this back, please fill in the form, which is on the next page here. Fill in the details. We will check the records from what we've got access to, and then issue those vouchers, usually in August. Throughout the booklet, you'll have seen lots of little symbols. This explains what we're going to do with the information that you provide. If you have any other data protection questions, obviously please email transition@bingleygrammar.org and I'll try to answer them as best I can. That concludes the data collection booklet. All I will ask you to do is complete it fully and return it back to school as soon as possible. Also then return and include the photograph to transition@bingleygrammar.org. And other than that, may I welcome your child to Bingley Grammar, and I look forward to seeing them in September. Thank you.